Good morning. We welcome you to the worship service for the Church of the Advent Episcopal in Brownsville, Texas. We are so grateful that you've chosen to worship with us today. Let us begin. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Keep, O Lord, your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion, for the sake of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the Old Testament, Genesis 18, 1 through 15, 21 through 7. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre. As he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day, he looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourselves and that may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "They're in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age, and it had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of woman. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord?' At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. He said, "Oh yes, you did laugh." The Lord dealt with Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, At the time in which God had spoken to him, Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son whom Sarah bore him. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 years old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Now Sarah said, God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me. And she said, who would ever have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age.
Psalm 116:1, 10-17. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication. Because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I called upon him. How shall I repay the Lord for all good things he has done for me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds. I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem, hallelujah.
The Epistle, Romans chapter 5, verses 1-8. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God, and not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we are still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, oh, fix me on it, mount of God's unchanging love. Here I find my greatest treasure, hither by thy help I've come. And I hope by thy good pleasure, safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, interpose his precious blood.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out, and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey or two tunics or sandals or a staff. For laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly, I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep in the midst of wolves. So be as wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. And children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
A debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Again, I'd like to welcome you to this worship service with the Church of the Advent in Brownsville. And I'd like to begin this reflection this morning with prayer number 35 from our Book of Common Prayer. If you have a Book of Common Prayer that you're using at home, it can be found on page 826. And it's also printed out in our online bulletin, I think about page 6, immediately following the reading of the Gospel. Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God, we remember before you all poor and neglected persons whom it would be easy for us to forget, the homeless and the destitute, the old and the sick, and all who have none to care for them. Help us to heal those who are broken in body or spirit, and to turn their sorrow into joy. Grant this, Father, for the love of your Son, who for our sake became poor, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I wanted to share with you that my mom and I recently watched the PBS series Cranbrook. It originally aired in 2007. And it's set in the 1840s. This miniseries was about a small English village made up of mostly ordinary people living simple lives who neither wanted nor expected great change. As with most PBS masterpiece classics, the character development was excellent. And in no time at all, we were invested in the lives of these townspeople, one of whom was an older woman, Matilda Jenkins, played by Judy Dench. Judy Dench is always excellent, right? I think the thing that was so remarkable about this character was the continual compassion she had for her friends and family, even when they sometimes behaved rather badly. The essence of Maddie Jenkins was compassion. Her first response in every situation was to consider the feelings of the other person, never herself. I would imagine that many of us would like to be like this. I would imagine that many of us try to be like this. And we are sometimes successful, maybe even oftentimes successful. But I haven't known many people in my life who could be first defined by their compassionate nature. I've known a few, and they are treasures in this world. But I would say most of us tend to get hung up on the question of merit. Does this person, friend or stranger, deserve compassion? Likely they've done something wrong, made a bad judgment or decision. Maybe they've been lazy or negligent or weak, maybe even dishonest. And this gets in our way of compassion. Today's gospel story speaks of Jesus' compassion. It begins with a summary of all that Jesus and his disciples had been doing. We read, Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. People from all over were following him. At times, the crowds were so large that they were barely manageable. At times, Jesus tried to find some quiet time to rest, reflect, and pray. But the people were relentless. Remember the story of the feeding of the 5,000? This number count was probably only of men, also probably accompanied by as many women and children. Large crowds, indeed. Exhausting, wouldn't you imagine? And yet, Matthew goes on to tell us, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. When I was studying and preparing for this homily and studying the scripture, this is the sentence that really jumped off the page for me in this difficult time in our history. Harassed and helpless. I think there are many of us who are struggling to live under our current conditions. Most of us only half living our lives, if that, unsure of what our new normal should look like. Parents home with children because schools and daycares are so restricted or even closed. Children home with parents because we hope it is the best way to care for them and keep them safe. Families huddled together. Now that part may be the best part, in their own bubble, but still pretty much isolated from everyone else. Kids missing their friends, people of all ages anxious to get out and do and be, to return to the life we knew. Take this for example. I seldom went to the movies before this pandemic, but now external forces are preventing me from going to the movies. It's no longer my choice, really. It's no longer an easy decision to make. Why would I miss something that I rarely did? It's not really the movies that I miss, certainly not the popcorn, but there is a piece of me that inwardly rails that I can't go to the movies. My freedom has been restricted, and I don't like that one bit. Churches have been struggling also with closed doors at a time when some people most want to be there, to seek God, to seek healing, to seek their community that oftentimes feels like family. We're not the only ones who are downcast and dispirited. Who else? We must learn to see as Jesus saw. Who are the others who are harassed and helpless, to whom we have turned a blind eye, who are invisible to us as we struggle with our own fears and loneliness? Have we failed to see those whom Jesus saw? This question is important for our reflection, because the next part of our gospel story from today is our mission, the sending out into the world, to see with the same eyes as Jesus, to have compassion with hearts like Jesus. The charge to the disciples then, and to us disciples now, is to proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near, to offer God's peace to others, to bring God's healing to others. And then Jesus says, you received without payment, give without payment. We are blessed to know Jesus. We have each been given many gifts, and Jesus expects us to offer them to others in the same way that we receive them, freely, without restriction. We have been loved and cherished by God. Jesus charges us with loving our neighbors as ourselves. We have been forgiven over and over, day after day. Jesus calls us to forgive others without condition. We have so many times received God's mercy and grace. Jesus beseeches us to be merciful, without judgment, without deciding who deserves it and who doesn't. And not even Jesus can do this monumental task alone. Jesus asks us to join with him in this mission. Freely we have been given, not deserving. Freely and with compassion we are called to give. Jesus sends us out to do the work that springs from a heart filled with compassion, with empathy, with doing our best to experience another's pain. Compassionate hearts have no place for criticism, for judgment, even for merit. We help those who need our help, not those we deem worthy of our help. It is not our own help we offer, of course. We are merely the vehicles for Christ's healing touch, his saving grace, his word of hope. I wonder, did you hear our opening collect today? To me, it seems to be a synopsis of our gospel reading. It went like this. Keep, O Lord, your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion. For the sake of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Your household, the church. I am so grateful that we are members together of this great household. Family. Amen. Please join with me as we confirm our faith, saying together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please join me in the prayers of the people form two. And during the time of silence after each petition, I invite you to add your own prayers of intercession and thanksgiving. I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, for David, our diocesan bishop, and for Lori, our rector. We pray for this Thanksgiving, for the Church of the Province of Myanmar, Burma, the Most Reverend Stephen Tan Myint U, Archbishop of Myanmar, and Bishop of Yangon, and for Habitat Builders of West Texas. Pray for the church. We pray for our Episcopal Day School, Brian Klein, Director, Kathy Martinez, Beginning Spanish Library, and St. John's Episcopal Day School in McAllen, Texas. Pray for all places of learning, especially our Episcopal and Anglican schools. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill amongst nations, for Donald, our president, for Greg, our governor, and Trey, our mayor, and for the well-being of all people, for those serving in the armed forces, especially Mike, Michael, Rico, and Noah. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. We lift up to you, Holy Lord, those many medical care workers, first responders, food suppliers, and all who are risking their lives for others during this pandemic. For the hospital shelters and those places that have been converted into temporary medical care facilities, we pray for your blessings upon them and all who are there being cared for and caring for others. We are thankful for your holy healing, most merciful God, and for your presence with us. We pray especially for Rosie Pons, Santiago and Javier Nunez, Esli Hernandez, Kathy Morrow, Ignacio Garza, and Emily Wegner. Please join with me now as we pray together the prayer for people facing great uncertainty. God in the present moment, God who in Jesus stills the storm and soothes the frantic heart, bring hope and courage to all who work or wait in uncertainty. Bring hope that you will make them the equal of whatever lies ahead. Bring them courage to endure what cannot be avoided, for your will is the health and wholeness. You are God, and we need you. Amen. Pray for all who have been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of Him. Pray that they may find and be found by Him. I ask your prayers for Ron, Charles, Sandy, Yolanda, Ron, Patty, Maria, Ricardo, Pat, Bill, Rick, Jill, Joe, John, Ethan, Logan, Lynn, Erica, Jean, Blanca, Keitha, David, Gina, Dwayne, Yolanda, Estella, Barbara, Sarah, Jill, Carol, Joe, Suzanne, Melanie, Anna, Cruz, Chawa, Lizeth, Joel, Ryland, Mary, Matt, Dora, Hilda, Carolyn, Wilma, and Carol. Pray that they may be healed, body, mind, and spirit. I ask your prayers for Thanksgiving for Ruben, Barbara, Mercedes, and Benjamin Rodriguez, for their faith and service to you. Pray for those whose lives bless ours. I ask your prayers for the departed, especially Frank Parker and Angie Arambula. Pray for those who have died. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day. Amen.
Grant, O God, that your holy and life-giving Spirit may so move every human heart, and especially the hearts of the people of this land, that barriers which divide us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatreds cease. That our divisions being healed, we may live in justice and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Amen. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself, in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now for those of you who are with us in spirit but cannot be physically present here, we will pray together the act of reception, a prayer of spiritual communion. In union, blessed Jesus, with the faithful gathered at every altar of your church, where your blessed body and blood are offered this day, I long to offer you praise and thanksgiving for creation and all the blessings of this life, for the redemption won for us by your life, death, and resurrection, for the means of grace and the hope of glory. I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament, and since I cannot at this time receive communion, I pray you to come into my heart. I unite myself with you and embrace you with all my heart, my soul, and my mind. Let nothing separate me from you. Let me serve you in this life until by your grace I come to your glorious kingdom and unending peace. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Jason, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Amen.
Laurie, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Let us pray. Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in my heart in the fullness of your strength. Be my wisdom and guide me in right pathways. Conform my life and actions to the image of your holiness. And in the power of your gracious might, rule over every hostile power that threatens or disturbs the growth of your kingdom. Who with the Father and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you forever. Amen.
Christ her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and to one hope she
Alleluia, alleluia. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.